Hello everyone, welcome. How are you doing today?
Hello everyone, welcome.
So this is what happens when you keep your phone switched on and waiting for you to start off the session. Anyway, a very good evening to all of you. I hope you're all doing well. I'm your host, Abhilasha, and I'm here for yet another session where I'll be discussing the Hindu and we'll be analyzing it with a perspective of reading comprehension. So that's the agenda for today's session. Before I begin, let me quickly take you through my bio. My name is Abhilasha. I've done my MBA from Jaipuria. I have 21 years of teaching and mentoring experience for CAT, for CLAT, for GMAT, Bank PO, SSC and other exams. I'm co-author of a book called Quantitative Aptitude and Reasoning, which was published by Cengage in this year. And I'm very pleased to say that we are in our second print run now. I used to write a column in the very popular newspaper called INX, which was being published in 24 cities. I've taught for CAT with Time, with Career Launcher, with professional tutorials. I've also taught for CLAT. Currently, I'm a test prep member of this institute called Legal Sapiens, where we are teaching students for CLAT. So anyway, that's a lot about me. You don't really need to know that much about me. Yes, you do need to know how to get in touch with me. So of course, my Telegram link is given here right at the bottom. That's Abhilasha English. My FB and Instagram links are also mentioned here. I'm Abhilasha Swarup and you can find me on all social media by this name. So of course, that's the easiest thing to do. On Unacademy, of course, you can find me by my ID, which is Abhilasha_S. Feel free to shoot me as many messages, doubts, questions, reviews, and all of that as and when you feel like it. Let me quickly introduce to you guys my courses for this week. I'm starting three courses this week. My first course is a vocabulary course, which is starting tomorrow. That's at 10 p.m. every day. For the next 2 weeks, I'll be discussing all of vocabulary for CAT. I'm also starting 2 weekend batches for my weekend students who are working somewhere. So one will be vocabulary through PYQs for CAT. That's starting 22nd Feb at 10 a.m. And there'll be another session called critical reasoning for CAT, which is also starting 22nd Feb. But that, of course, will be from 4 p.m. You can use my referral code ABHICAT to get 10% discounts on all CAT 2020 and CAT 21 courses. Anyway, yeah, that's not really important. I just hope that you will learn as much as possible from all of my sessions, whether it is the YouTube sessions, whether it is the free classes, whether it is our plus courses. The idea is that I should be able to get across to you and you should be able to make the most of all my classes for CAT, for CET Maharashtra, for all possible exams. So that's the whole idea. Anyway, let's get on with our goal for today, and that is to do one session on analysis of the Hindu. So like I say, what is it that you should read to improve your reading comprehension? I'm always saying that the newspaper is, of course, our best friend. So read The Hindu, read Telegraph, read Indian Express, read any newspaper of your choice. We'll be very, very happy. There are 5 pages that you need to read. That's the front page, the international page, the business page, the sports page, and most importantly, the op-ed pages, the opinions and editorial pages. So they are the most important pages that you must read. Apart from this, I've also told you this, that you must do novels, as many of them as possible. Look for classics, look for self-help, philosophy, and also look for all prize winners. So the Booker Prize winners and all the good prize winners, please do read up those books. You'll always find it great fun. Today, of course, I'm going to be discussing one editorial from Hindu. This is Cat Conundrum on Cheetahs in Indian Forest. This is not the cat as we know it. This is not CAT, Common Admission Test, but this is about cheetahs to be put into Indian forests, to be imported from foreign countries and put into our forests. So let's read a bit and let's try and understand what the passage is all about. The passage is very simple. Let's read it together. The Supreme Court's order enabling the introduction of exotic cheetahs to an Indian habitat on an experimental basis has naturally led to renewed enthusiasm among wildlife lovers, who see in it a potential bulwark against creeping pressures on habitats. So the Supreme Court has ordered that exotic cheetahs should be brought from abroad and put into an Indian forest on an experimental basis. Now, this news has created a great hullabaloo among the wildlife lovers, who think it could probably be very helpful towards making sure that we have cheetahs in our jungles and making sure that the biodiversity is right. As a graceful animal that was hunted and extirpated in the country in the 20th century, the cat has periodically inspired campaigns for a fresh introduction, mainly inspired by the nationalistic sense of loss. So the cheetah has already been hunted and finished off in our country, but people still feel that because it is a very important animal for us, we feel that nationalistic sense of loss, and therefore there are renewed campaigns again and again to bring back the cheetah. Remarkably, the antiquity of the high-speed hunter that formed part of Mughal hunting groups has been a matter of scientific debate, with much literature tracing the origins of the Asiatic cheetah to about 2 lakh years ago, and one recent hypothesis arguing in contrast that it appears to be a relatively modern alien import to India. So now we really don't know if the cheetah actually belongs to India or not, or was it an alien import? Or have we brought it from some other foreign country into our country? And are we just, or was it really a part of the Indian animal system? Okay, I hope you've understood this. Let's look at the words. The important words here were exotic, which means unusual and extremely interesting. Bulwark, of course, is a protective wall. Extirpated means destroyed. Antiquity, of course, means old. Hypothesis, we understand, is any sort of theory. And alien, of course, is strange or unusual. Questions that struck me, and there are many questions that struck me. Why are these enthusiasts so excited about the introduction of foreign cheetahs? Are Indian cheetahs all dead that we need cheetahs to come from abroad and be placed in our jungles? Were the cheetahs actually truly Indian ever, or have they always been foreign imports? Have we always brought them from abroad and, you know, made sure that they were here? So these are interesting questions that plague me as I say. Words, of course, I've already discussed with you. The theme here was bringing cheetahs to India. So this paragraph essentially talks about how we are bringing cheetahs into India and whether that has been something that's already been done at some prior time also. The keywords that would strike you would be renewed enthusiasm, sense of loss, modern alien imports. Now, these keywords actually help to point out the theme of the paragraph. All right, let's come to the second paragraph. With a group surviving in Iran, there is growing interest in preserving the Asian population. Whatever its origins, it is illogical to expect that a new population, whether from Africa or Iran, will fare better today than in the past. It is worth recalling that the same court observed in its 2013 order restraining the Environment Ministry from importing African cheetahs into Kuno, Madhya Pradesh, that there are many seriously threatened Indian species such as the lion, the great Indian bustard, Bengal florican, the dugong, the Manipur brow antlered deer, which deserve immediate conservation action. So now there is a set of cheetahs that are Asiatic cheetahs that are existing in Iran. So only those. So we want to preserve the population. But wherever it is, wherever you're bringing the cheetahs from, it is not very sure, or it is not very certain whether these cheetahs or whether this new population will be able to maintain its numbers. Because earlier also we've brought the cheetahs into the country, but we've not been able to maintain the numbers. They've all died. Now, you must also remember that the Supreme Court had earlier said that because there are already so many Indian species that are threatened, why is it that we really need to bring another species from abroad and then try and protect it? So that's a very unusual and interesting thing that we must pay attention to. Now, words that are important here, of course, were preserving. Preserving means safekeeping, keeping them safe. Fair means will exist or will remain. Observed, of course, we understand is to view or note. And conservation, of course, is to conserve or to preserve or to keep safe. Questions that strike me were, will the new population survive? If we bring these new cheetahs into the country, are they going to survive? Should we expect it to? Because it has already, we've already decimated it once. So is it possible that we'll be able to maintain it even now, this time? Why get new species if the others are still unprotected? If we have so many species that need conservation action, then why get these new species into the country, spend more money, more effort? So whatever is remaining, let's at least save those. The theme here, of course, was, will this idea be successful? Bringing new cheetahs from abroad, will this be successful? So that's the theme in this paragraph. Keywords here were growing interest, illogical, fair, better, immediate action. All of these tell us that this is incorrect. Okay, all right. Let's look at the next paragraph. Any move to rewild India's threatened natural spaces with cheetahs, which require large grassland ranges, should consider the viability of such a program. Man-animal conflicts is an area of concern, as a growing human population lives cheek by jowl with tigers, leopards, and long-ranging creatures such as elephants. While the court has appointed an expert committee to guide and direct the experiment proposed by National Tiger Conservation Authority, it needs a broader scientific inquiry into the added pressures that a small group of introduced predators will impose on an ecosystem, crucially on the prey base that currently sustains tigers and leopards. So what this is saying is that if you think of rewilding the natural spaces with new cheetahs, then you have to consider the viability of such a program. Will it be actually viable? Will you have enough space to have these cheetahs? Because cheetahs, leopards, elephants need lots of big empty spaces, and we don't really have that many big empty spaces. So there is the Supreme Court has appointed a committee to guide and direct the experiment, but you need a broader scientific inquiry. So a lot of thought has to go into this, that how are we going to protect these animals that we are bringing into the system. All right, let's look at the words here. So rewild means to re-establish them, okay? Viability, of course, means sustainability. Cheek by jowl is together. Predators, of course, we understand means animals that will prey on others. Crucially, very important. Crucial means important. And sustains means to maintain. All right, questions that would strike us would, do we have enough grasslands? And the passage says that we probably don't. Will man-animal conflict grow? Yes, if there isn't enough space, then surely the man-animal conflict will grow. Will these predators affect current wildlife? Probably they will, because all the animals that are already existing there and these new animals will naturally, there will be some burden on the ecosystem. So some of them will die out. So that current wildlife is going to be affected. The theme here was, is rewilding going to be an imposition on the current situation? And the keywords that tell us that were threatened natural spaces, viability, added pressure, crucially impose. Okay. All right. Let's come to the last and the fourth part of the passage. Any attempt at expensive rewilding will be negated by parallel efforts to liberalize environmental clearances for extractive industries in and around forests. So, whenever you will try and rewild at a very expensive cost, then this effort will be negated. By what? By the government's effort to set up extract extractive industries. So there are going to be mineral extraction industries. They will require environmental clearances, and government will give those environmental clearances. So that balance of power will not be maintained. If you're trying to bring in animals, then you cannot have extractive industries in and around the forest. Material extraction, including minerals, is going on close to protected areas, and fresh roads are sought to be built through even tiger territory, making pristine rewilding an incongruous concept. So you're trying to extract minerals, and this is happening around protected areas, around animal territory. So then rewilding and extraction cannot happen together. Moreover, cheetahs are genetically fragile and lose cubs in a litter prematurely, affecting the establishment of a viable population. So this is the second reason that cheetahs, because they're genetically fragile and the cubs die very quickly, so to have a viable population will be difficult. Restoring ecology and diverse species cannot be a serious goal in the absence of ironclad protections to existing parks, sanctuaries, migratory corridors and buffer areas. Now, if you want to restore ecology and diverse species, then if you don't have ironclad protection for the parks, sanctuaries, corridors and buffer areas, then how are you going to make sure that ecology and diverse species are going to be restored? On one side, you have jungles and people are encroaching on them. On the other side, you want to rewild them. Is that even possible? No. So, preserving wild spaces with surviving species should be the first order priority. So, the writer says here that if you want to have newer animals, the first thing that should be done is you preserve your wild spaces with the surviving species. So, whatever animals are currently there, first make sure that they exist, give them their space, and then bring in whatever new animals you feel like bringing in. Now, important words here, of course, were liberalized to make easy, extractive. Extractive means wherever extraction of any sort is happening. Sought means made an effort to or searched. Pristine means clean, unsullied. Fragile is something that is easily broken or destroyed. Ecology is the study of our environment. Ironclad means strong, and priority means the preference. Alright, questions that will strike us here. Why will rewilding efforts be negated? Obviously, they will be negated because on one hand, you have the extractive industries at work. So clearly, that will be negated. Is extraction of minerals good? Yes, sometimes you need to extract these minerals, no? So then, of course, can we really say that extraction is bad? No, we cannot. Should we first make space for these animals? Yeah, let's make space for our animals first and then bring in newer animals. The theme of this part of our passage was that rewilding may be threatened by mining, etc., etc. So it is not very certain if rewilding will occur properly. Keywords that point to this theme were negated, incongruous concept, not a serious goal, absence of ironclad protection. So all of these say that rewilding may actually be threatened by all the efforts made by the government for protection of extractive industries. All right, let's quickly look at the main idea of this passage. I hope you've understood this. The main idea was very, very simple. The government gives permission to import exotic cheetahs. Okay, but will this be useful? Is it certain for us that we will be able to import these cheetahs and make sure that they survive? So the passage was essentially talking about this. Supreme Court has given an order that you should bring in cheetahs. But remember that there are extractive industries, there are people who are mining all around the forest, people who are building resorts in the sanctuaries. Now, if you have these resorts, if you have mines in the forests, in the jungles, in these parks and sanctuaries, then will you be able to give the animals the kind of empty, wild, long spaces that they require? Probably not. And if you cannot give them all this, then how are you even going to make sure that the cheetahs that come are going to survive? So the passage is essentially talking about this. The first paragraph talked about how the Supreme Court has said that we should bring cheetahs to India from abroad. Then the passage also says that these cheetahs are actually not native to India. We've had them brought from abroad earlier, probably in the Mughal eras or something. The cheetahs were brought from abroad. Also, the paragraph says that the existing cheetahs were all hunted down and killed in the last century. The second paragraph comes and says, will this idea of bringing these foreign animals be successful? Because then it says that Supreme Court in an earlier order has said that whatever are the existing animals, first we must protect them. Once we have saved them, then it has to bring in newer animals and to save them, right? So then it becomes very important to be able to analyze whether this will be successful. The writer probably tells you that it's not going to be a successful idea. The third thing that the passage says is that rewilding will be an imposition. Because remember, we already have very limited space. Man-animal conflict is already at a head. There is hardly any space for the existing wild animals. So if there is no space for the existing wild animals, how are we going to make space for newer animals? So if we do bring in these cheetahs from abroad, one, how are the cheetahs going to adjust to our Indian animals? Two, will there be enough space? Our lion, our tigers, our elephants, the smaller animals, and then we bring in these cheetahs. So how are we going to make sure that the cheetahs exist? Then also that mining is occurring. Lots of liberalization of the mine rules for mining have happened because the government wanted mining to occur. It's a multi-million dollar industry for India. So then in that case, the government did want that mining should occur. But where does the mining happen? It happens in and around the forest. Now, if it is happening in and around the forest, then how will you make sure that these animals survive? So therefore, the writer says that rewilding is going to be pretty difficult. Then the last paragraph again, he continues on this line only and he says that rewilding may be threatened by mining. It is entirely possible that these mines may be at cross purpose with the people who are trying to bring these animals into the jungles, into the Indian ecology system. So somewhere the idea of introduction of these cats, the exotic cheetahs, is a very dicey one. Because remember, cheetahs are genetically fragile, so they have very few numbers. So we bring in the cheetahs, the cubs will die. So the existence or the viability of this cheetah is very low. That's one. Two, because there is a space conflict, there's going to be a food conflict also. The same food is being sought after by other animals also. The same space is being sought after by the other animals. So there is going to be this animal versus animal conflict. And then finally, of course, there will be the animal versus man conflict. Because of course, the mining, the tourist industry, all of that will cause this man versus animal conflict. So three levels of conflict. The animal itself is fragile. One. Two, the animal versus other animals. And three, the animal versus man. So there are three levels of fight for existence for these poor cheetahs that we are planning to import. So does it really make sense to bring these cheetahs into the country? Is something that the writer wants you to understand and think about. All right, let's try and answer a few questions. I've tried to create a couple of questions which will be interesting. So guys, all those who are online, I would like you all to try and answer this question also. So why is the government bringing cheetahs from other countries? A, because there are currently no cheetahs in India. B, because new species will bring diversity to the animal population. And C, because there is a sense of loss due to the extirpation of cheetahs in the 20th century. Okay, so let's see if any of you can answer this question. I am also online on the chat. So I'm able to see your answers. So let's understand what the answer should be for this question. Why is the government bringing cheetahs from other countries? The passage has already said that there are currently no cheetahs in India. All the cheetahs have been destroyed. New species will bring diversity to the animal population is true, but this has not been mentioned in the passage. Therefore, this cannot be the right answer. Look at the third one. There is a sense of loss due to extirpation of the cheetahs in the 20th century. The writer has also mentioned this in the passage. So the writer has mentioned both point A and point C in the passage. Therefore, our correct answer is going to be D for question 1. Okay, let's look at the next question. Why had the Supreme Court previously restrained the import of African cheetahs to Kuno in Madhya Pradesh? Now, earlier in that second paragraph that we had read that the Supreme Court had stopped the import of African cheetahs to Kuno, and it said that because there were already many Indian species requiring our help and requiring those same resources, therefore, there was no need to import other animals into the forest. And therefore, the correct answer here clearly has to be B, which says there are many Indian species needing those same resources. Let's look at the third question. So why is the author suggesting that preserving the wild spaces with existing animals is more important than getting new species? Okay, let's understand. Because existing animals are easier to preserve, because importing new animals may be extremely prohibitive in terms of cost, because bringing new species without giving them safe spaces to exist would not be helpful, and because the new species would kill the existing animals. So clearly here the writer has already told us that because there is a conflict, man-animal conflict, animal-to-animal conflict, and therefore it is going to be very, very dicey about protecting them. It is entirely possible that we will not be able to give them safe spaces to exist. And that's why the correct answer here is going to be C. Let's look at the last question here. How is this passage organized? Clearly, this is a descriptive passage. There is no comparison given here. Then it is not a narrative passage because, of course, it's a newspaper extract. So it's not narrative, and there is no contrast being mentioned also. So therefore, it has not been organized in a contrasting manner. Let's look at the words that we were discussing in this passage. The words were very interesting. So I've already told you these words. Let me quickly go through them again. So exotic is strange and interesting and wonderful. Bulwark, of course, is a protective wall. Extirpated means decimated or destroyed or completely finished. Antiquity means very old. Hypothesis is a theory that you create. Alien, of course, is strange, unusual. Preserving means safekeeping. Fair means to exist. Observed means noted. Conservation means protection. Rewild is to rehabilitate. Viability is sustainability. Cheek by jowl is together, very, very closely. Predator, of course, is an animal that looks to kill other animals. Crucial, of course, is importantly. Sustains is to maintain. Liberalize is to make easy. Extractive, of course, is where you extract something from the ground. Sought is to look for or search. Pristine is clear or clean. Fragile is something that's very weak. Ecology, of course, is the environment around you. Ironclad, of course, is strong. And priority is preference. I hope you've understood these words, guys. Let me quickly go back to our reminder. My batch details are simple. Tomorrow at 10 p.m. I start my vocabulary course for CAT. This weekend on Saturday on 22nd, I'm starting two courses. One will be vocabulary through PYQs for CAT. That is at 10 a.m. And my second course will be critical reasoning for CAT, which will be at 4 p.m. All three batches are focused towards helping people for CAT, for ZAD, for the other management entrance tests. This course is also very helpful for anyone who's writing CET Maharashtra this year. Guys, if you're planning on joining, please do use my referral code ABHICAT, get 10% discount. For any more details, for any discussions, feel free to message me on Unacademy, Abhilasha underscore S is my ID. And on Telegram, Abhilasha English, of course, is my ID there. Guys, that brings us to the end of today's session. I hope you were able to understand, and I hope this session was useful to you. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. I will see you day after with a novel analysis. Adios.